story you are about to see is a fib, but it's short. The names are made up, but the problems are real.
It was Monday, 9:43 a.m., and the layer of smog blanketing the Los Angeles basin was so thick you could cut it with a cliche. My partner is George Frankly. The boss is Thad Green. My name is Monday. I'm a mathematician. George and I had just come off the case of the hidden baffles, in which a case of baffles had been hidden. It was a baffling case, one which I'll tell you about sometime, but not today. Today, I hoped, would be quiet. Good morning, George. George.
Mathnet, Frankly.
Good morning, George.
Good morning, Kate. Coming in this morning?
Uh-huh. See you, George.
You bet.
Don't ask. Anything going on, George?
Nope. I was saying that to Martha just last night. Not much going on at the shop, I said to her.
Uh-huh.
I try not to take my work home, Kate. Sometimes a fellow has to just spill it.
It's a good idea not to hold it in.
Will that be you again, Kate? On the phone, I mean? Mathnet, Frankly. Really? What's the location? We'll be right out. Afraid I was wrong when I said nothing was going on.
What was that call about?
Somebody just stole a dump truck full of dirt.
Dirt?
Yeah, dirt. I told them we'd be right out. It's a truck stop in Eagle Rock.
Let's roll. Morning, sir. I'm Monday. This is my partner, George.
Frankly.
Mathnet.
Hi, I'm Ernie.
Got a last name, Ernie?
Sure.
Good.
You reported your truck was stolen?
Yeah, and I feel pretty silly now.
Oh?
Yeah, you see, this is my truck.
What makes you think it's stolen?
Well, it's not anymore. You see, I stopped by for a cup of mud and a couple of sinkers.
A what?
Sorry, that's truck driver talk for a cup of coffee and two donuts. Anyway, I was in there for about 35 minutes. When I came out of the diner, my truck was gone. I went back in and called you two. When I came out again about 10 minutes later, she was back.
She?
Yeah, my truck.
How can you tell a girl truck from a boy truck?
Girl trucks usually wear more chrome. Anyway, I'm sorry to have bothered you.
No problem. George, let's get back to headquarters.
Yes. I'll tell them as soon as they come in.
Morning, Debbie.
Hi, Debbie.
I just took a message for you, Mathnetters.
Somebody just swiped a dump truck full of dirt at Mom's truck stop and go.
We know. We just checked it out. The truck was returned.
The call just came in?
Just this minute. Driver named Gussie Bicep said she stopped for some mud and a couple of sinkers.
George, it's another one. This is getting to be an epidemic. Thanks, Debbie. George?
I know. Let's roll.
Yes, I'm Gussie Bicep.
And you're sure the truck was actually missing?
Yes, ma'am, it was gone.
Are you positive this is your truck?
Well, of course I'm positive.
Is it a boy or a girl?
What?
You came out, the truck was gone. You went back inside and called us?
Yes, ma'am, that's the truth. And then when I come back out here about 5 minutes ago, the truck was back.
Okay, well, I guess we can't be of any help.
Sorry to have bothered you folks.
That's all right. We get mileage.
I thought Ernie was making a mistake when he thought his truck was gone, but it's unlikely they both would have been wrong. Know what I mean, George?
George, what are you reading?
What's your sign, Kate?
My sign?
You know, your astrological sign. When were you born?
October 6th.
Libra. The scales. Balance. Here's your horoscope for today.
George, you don't really believe in those things.
No, they're just fun. It says, be careful in money matters. Neither a borrower nor a lender be. If life doesn't make sense, that's just the way things are sometimes.
Well, that certainly seems to be true.
Know what mine says? My chart, I mean?
Uh-uh.
Try to be a nice person, but watch out for a grizzly who might want to obliterate your name on a present.
What is that supposed to mean?
I'm not sure.
Oh.
What?
Beware of bears greeking gifts.
Mathnet, Monday. What, again? All right, we'll be right down.
Another dump truck disappearance?
Yep.
We gotta get a part-time job at that diner.
Yeah, let's roll. And when you came back out...
The truck was back.
How'd you know that?
Lucky guess.
Cup of mud, Kate?
I thought you'd never ask.
You know, Kate, maybe it's not a crime we're trying to solve.
What do you mean?
Maybe it's a prank. You know, somebody just fooling around like kids on Halloween. Ringing doorbells, soaping windows, extortion. Pranks like that.
What makes you say that, George?
Because nothing is missing from any of the trucks. One of the first things people learn when they go into the robbery business is to take something. Otherwise, there's no robbery.
But, George, something is missing.
What is missing?
The dirt. Someone is stealing the dirt.
The story you are about to see is a fib, but it's short. The names are made up, but the problems are real.
2:43 p.m. and absolutely gorgeous in San Francisco for that time of day, but we were working the day watch out of Mathnet in Los Angeles. My partner is George Frankly. The boss is Thad Green. My name is Monday. I'm a mathematician. We were working on the case of the missing dirt, a case involving the disappearance and reappearance of three dump trucks. When they were stolen, they were full of dirt. When they were returned, they were empty. We decided to look at a scene from yesterday's show to see if we had missed a clue.
You know, Kate, maybe it's not a crime we're trying to solve.
What do you mean?
Maybe it's a prank. You know, somebody just fooling around like kids on Halloween. Ringing doorbells, soaping windows, extortion. Pranks like that.
What makes you say that, George?
Because nothing is missing from any of the trucks. One of the first things people learn when they go into the robbery business is to take something. Otherwise, there's no robbery.
But, George, something is missing.
What is missing?
The dirt. Someone is stealing the dirt.
I remembered something else George said yesterday after having been called to the scene of three phony dump truck thefts within 4 hours. He said, maybe we should get part-time jobs here. And that's exactly what we did. With Steve and Sam posing as truck drivers, George and I took jobs as cook and counterman. We figured when the next dump truck load of dirt was stolen, we'd be on the scene to nab the perpetrator.
That's it.
Pig in a blanket.
What?
Ham sandwich, Kate. You get it? Pig in a blanket.
Uh-huh.
I like an onion with that, if you'd be so kind.
Pin a rose on it.
Hey, Bud.
Me?
What's the story with this bill? I bought a hamburger that your menu clearly says costs $3.
Yes, sir. That's one of our best sellers.
So what's this total?
That's right. $3.20.
What's the 20 cents for?
Tax.
I didn't have tax on my burger, just ketchup.
You know, the money that goes to help support our governments.
It doesn't say anything about tax on the menu.
Sales tax is 6.5%.
Uh-huh.
To find how much the tax amounts to, we have to find 6.5% of $3. To do that, we multiply $3 times 0.065, and we get 0.195. That's 19.5 cents. Round that up to 20 cents, and we get, see? $3.20.
Well, thank you for the arithmetic lesson. And here's your $3.20.
No tip?
Order up, George!
Cup of mud with that?
No. I'd rather have a cup of coffee.
We had been working at the stakeout for 2 days, and not one other truck had been stolen. Maybe we were taking the wrong approach to this problem.
You probably wouldn't recognize me in this getup, but I'm...
George Frankly, a Mathnet. How are you?
Fine, Gussie. Any more trouble with your truck?
Not a lick.
Gussie, was there anything special about that dirt you were hauling?
No, it was just, you know, dirt.
Hi, Gussie.
Hey, Ernie.
Hey, Mr. Frankly.
You two know each other?
Sure, we're working the same job.
Chef, can I see you for a moment?
Yep.
So you two are working for the same company?
Yep. Hey, guys, what's up? Your trucks aren't missing again.
No.
But they're working the same job.
And the third driver, too?
Barney? Yeah, they swapped his truck, too.
Where are you working?
Corner Parkwood and Valley View in Glendale. We're hauling from an excavation, taking the dirt out to Canyon Country and coming on back for more.
How long you been working there?
About a week.
Worth looking into. Come on, George. Let's roll.
Sure thing, Kate. Help yourselves to the mud.
Thanks for taking the time, Mr. Rourke.
Oh, not at all. Always happy to cooperate with the mathematician.
When three of your trucks were borrowed yesterday, the loads of dirt they were carrying were stolen.
Can you beat it? I've been in the building business, man and boy, and I've never heard of anything so strange.
Anything special about this soil?
No, I don't think so.
I noticed the numbers of the trucks that were taken were 2, 6, and 10. Does that suggest any kind of pattern that might be helpful in figuring this problem out?
2, 6, and 10. There's a difference of 4 between the truck numbers.
Well, over here. We've divided the excavation into 4 quadrants, A, B, C, and D. I'm using 12 trucks to load from the site.
Uh-huh.
To facilitate speed in loading, truck number 1 is loaded from here, truck number 2 from quadrant B, truck number 3 from C quadrant, etc.
Then what we find is, may I?
Kate, there is a pattern here.
Right. What we find is the trucks that were stolen, numbers 2, 6, and 10, were all carrying dirt from the same quadrant, quadrant B.
Guess you're right. I never thought of that before. But I don't think there's anything so special about any of this dirt. Well, take a look if you like. Go on, help yourself.
Thank you.
We brought a soil sample back to the lab where Debbie Williams analyzed it.
I've broken it down, mathematicians. Look at the charts.
What did you find? Gold ore? Uranium? Traces of crude oil?
Dirt.
Dirt?
Dirt. Nothing very unusual. It's got the normal mixture of organic and mineral matter, but nothing out of the ordinary. It has a slightly lower than average pH. It's at about a 5. 7 is normal. But that means that the soil is a little more acidic. But that's not unusual for this area.
Did you check it against the samples from the other 3 quadrants, Debbie?
Sure. It's the same.
Why would anybody steal truckloads of dirt?
Beats me.
Maybe he just digs dirt.
Mathnet, Monday. Oh, hello, Mr. Warwick. Thank you very much for returning my call. I was wondering if you could tell us how fast those dump trucks can go. 45 miles per hour? Thank you very much, sir. Let's try and figure out how far those trucks went.
Why, Kate?
They had to dump the dirt and get the trucks back to the truck stop. If we could figure out where they dumped the dirt, maybe we could shed some light on this puzzle.
We know the 3 drivers all stopped at the same place, and they all took a break of about 45 minutes.
But let's say the thief only had about 35 or 40 minutes in which to use the truck and dump the dirt.
Okay, but they could have driven no more than 20 minutes one way, because they had to come back.
And Rourke said the truck could go 45 miles an hour.
45 miles in 60 minutes.
But they could only go 20 minutes each way.
20 is what fraction of 60 minutes?
20 is 1/3 of 60. So if the truck could go 45 miles in 1 hour, it can only go 1/3 that far in 20 minutes.
So figure 1/3 of 45 miles.
15 miles. Borrow your map, Debbie?
First, let's look at the scale. On this map, 1 inch represents 1 mile. So 15 inches would be 15 miles. Here's where the trucks were taken.
So set the compass radius at 15 inches, and that'll show us where he might have dumped the dirt.
We don't know it was a he.
Good point.
Well, he or she wouldn't have dumped it on the freeway or in downtown Glendale, or we would have heard about it.
They may have dumped it somewhere up here.
Abandoned gravel pits.
Gravel pits. They could have dumped it there and no one would ever notice. Let's get out there.
After searching the abandoned gravel pit to no avail, we finally spotted something unusual. We decided to take a closer look.
What do you make of it, Kate?
Someone was digging here.
It's as though they were looking for something.
What if the dirt isn't valuable?
Uh-huh.
What if something that is valuable
was buried in the dirt?
The story you are about to see is a fib, but it's short. The names are made up, but the problems are real.
9:43 a.m., and traffic was nose-to-nose because the recent Santa Ana winds had dried up every nasal passage in the valley. We were working the day watch out of Mathnet. My partner is George Frankly. The boss is Thad Green. My name is Monday. I'm a mathematician. We had been working on a bizarre case which involved the theft of 3 truckloads of dirt. The trucks were returned. The dirt was not. We decided to look at a scene from yesterday's show to refresh our memories. It's good to think hard about problems. Especially hard problems.
They may have dumped it somewhere up here.
Abandoned gravel pits.
Gravel pits. They could have dumped it there and no one would ever notice. Let's get out there.
After searching the abandoned gravel pit to no avail, we finally spotted something unusual. We decided to take a closer look.
What do you make of it, Kate?
Someone was digging here.
It's as though they were looking for something.
What if the dirt isn't valuable?
Uh-huh.
What if something that is valuable
was buried in the dirt?
Hi, Kate. I just gave George the lab report on the new dirt.
It has the same composition as the old dirt, Kate.
Uh-huh. Debbie, we think something valuable was buried in the dirt. We need to know it was standing on the site before the hole was dug. Can you check with the Bureau of Records?
You got it.
I'll call Mr. Rourke and make sure no other trucks have been stolen. Mr. Rourke? George Frankly, Mathnet. Any more trouble at the excavation site, sir? Nothing? No more trucks missing? I see. Thank you, sir. Kate, I think we can make an assumption.
What's that?
Whoever was sifting through the dirt found what he was looking for.
Monday. Yes, Debbie. I see. Got a new address on them? Thanks. George, there was a housing project on the site. We've got the name of the couple that lived there before the excavation. Let's roll.
A couple named Swaggle had lived in the house that occupied the site, and they had just recently moved into a new home. We decided to pay a call and introduce ourselves.
Yes?
Mrs. Swaggle, I'm Kate Monday. This is my partner, George.
Frankly, Mathnet.
Man, the Goshen, what do you want with little old me?
Just wonder if you could answer a couple of questions about your former residence.
Is this some sort of door-to-door game show or something? Oh, I hope. I was almost kissed by Richard Dawson once.
On Family Feud?
No.
Mrs. Swaggle, was there anything unusual about your house? Anything at all?
Not that you'd notice. It was just a little cracker box of a house. 2 bedrooms and a bath and a quarter and a carport. Just like all the other houses in the area.
What about the landscaping? Anything unusual there?
No. The front lawn was just a little postage stamp, and the back lawn was even smaller. Mr. Swaggle used to mow it with my peeking shears.
How long did you live there, ma'am?
20 years. Oh, it was a charming little place. We put it on the market for $350,000, and it sold in less than 10 minutes.
I'm happy for you.
It was almost enough for a down payment on this jobby.
We have reason to suspect someone may have buried something valuable on your lot.
Nothing like that ever happened when we lived there.
If you think of anything, please give us a call.
Just one more thing, Mrs. Swaggle.
Yes, young man.
What's Richard Dawson really like?
George.
By the way, who did you buy the house from?
The bank. It was a foreclosure.
I got some info on the previous owner of the house, Mathnetters. It was owned by a man named Merle Fish. He couldn't keep up the mortgage payments and the bank took it away.
Merle Fish? That name rings a bell.
It should. He was convicted of pulling off the famous Finks Armored Car Robbery about 21 years ago. He was sent to state prison.
No wonder he couldn't make his mortgage payments.
The Finks Armored Car Robbery. I studied that case in Mathnet school. The guy got away with $1 million. They caught him, but never got the money back.
The theory was, if I recall, that Fish had an accomplice who got away with the money and left the country.
There was a book written about it at the time, wasn't there?
Yes, it was called Marilyn. A Finks truck, written by Norman Mailbag.
Is Fish still in prison?
According to this, he was sentenced to 30 years. He's got 9 to make.
George, call the warden and see when we can talk with Mr. Fish. Debbie, call the Finks company and see if they have records of the serial numbers of the bills.
Thank you, sir.
George, how'd you make out? Did you talk to the warden?
Yes, I did, Kate.
Can we see Merle Fish?
Afraid not. The warden's a powerful man, but he's not that powerful.
What do you mean?
Merle Fish died in prison 6 days ago.
About to see is a fib, but it's short. The names are made up, but the problems are real.
9:43 a.m. and cool in Los Angeles. Very cool. We were working the day watch out of Mathnet. My partner is George Frankly. The boss is Thad Green. The capital of North Dakota is Bismarck. My name is Monday. I'm a mathematician. We were working on the problem of the missing dirt and had come up with some interesting twists. While trying to find out what was important about 3 dump truckloads of dirt which had been stolen, we learned that the dirt had once belonged to Merle Fish, a man who was in prison for pulling off one of the most spectacular robberies in the annals of crime, the Finks Armored Car Caper, in which he stole $1 million. The money was never recovered. When you're dealing with a complicated problem, it's a good idea to review your facts and hypotheses. We decided to do just that by looking at a couple of scenes from yesterday's show.
Thank you, sir.
George, how'd you make out? Did you talk to the warden?
Yes, I did, Kate.
Can we see Merle Fish?
Afraid not. The warden's a powerful man, but he's not that powerful.
What do you mean?
Merle Fish died in prison 6 days ago.
Morning, George.
Morning, Kate.
I read the book about the Finks case last night, George.
Did you, Kate? I tubed out. You know, watch television.
Uh-huh.
Watched a rerun of Dragnet. You know, with Jack Webb.
Uh-huh.
Golly, that was a good show.
According to the author Norman Mailbag, Merle Fish had an accomplice.
Someone helped him pull off the robbery?
Uh-huh. I checked through the police records this morning, and the general consensus is that the accomplice took the money and left the country.
Bet he's having a good time. Spending his ill-gotten gains, I mean.
Hi, team. I've got a couple of things that might interest you.
Shoot.
To begin with, the Finks people do have the serial numbers of those stolen bills.
Well, that would mean if the robber spent any of the money, the numbers on the bills could be checked and he would get caught.
Right.
What else have you got, Debbie?
I checked the prison records to see what I could find out about Merle Fish.
And?
He was a strange con. He became a recluse. Hardly ever spoke to anyone. Not prison officials, guards, not even his fellow inmates. And in 21 years, had only one person visit him.
One person?
Yes. A fellow by the name of Norman Mailbag.
He's the man that wrote the book about the Finks case.
Probably visited Fish to get the facts.
Yes, but he continued to visit him long after the book was published. In fact, he saw him just 10 days ago.
I don't know why exactly, and maybe he has nothing to do with the missing dirt. But I think we should talk to Mr. Mailbag.
I thought you might. Here's his address.
Mailbag. I'm Kate Munday. This is my partner, George.
Frankly,
Mathnet.
What can I do for you?
We know you wrote the famous book about the Finks caper.
Yes, I did.
And that you probably know more about the case than anyone else?
I'm sure I do.
Now, we understand that you kept in touch with Merle Fish long after your book was published.
Oh, yes. Merle and I became quite close during the interviews that I had with him when I was writing the book.
I see.
He was a lonely man, and I tried to cheer him up from time to time.
I wonder, in all the years that you knew him, Mr. Mailbag, did he ever tell you what happened to the money?
You didn't read my book.
I haven't gotten to it yet. You know how your reading mounts up?
But I did.
Well, then you know what really happened to the money. Fish told me the absolute truth, just the way I wrote it.
According to your book, he had an accomplice.
That's what the police said. And that's what Merle Fish said. And when Fish was arrested, the accomplice took the money and left the country.
But if the serial numbers were known, why hasn't any of the money shown up?
European banks and South American banks aren't as interested in tracing American dollars as American banks are. No, I'm sure whoever the accomplice was had a wonderful time with that $1 million somewhere. Now, if you will excuse me.
One other thing, Mr. Mailbag. You said that Merle Fish told you everything about the Finks case?
Yes, and that's why my book has become the definitive treatise on the case.
Who was Fish's accomplice?
Well, I have to admit that that is one thing that he never did reveal.
Going on a trip, Mr. Mailbag?
Yes, yes. Time for a short vacation. If you will excuse me.
Thank you for your help, sir. Mm-hmm.
I got a strange feeling about Mailbag, didn't you?
A little bit, yeah. He's pretty slick.
You know what Scott Fitzgerald said about writers, don't you?
What?
He said, all writers are liars, which is why what they write is called fiction.
That was William Faulkner, but you made your point.
Mathnetters, I got something for you. I analyzed the soil from Mailbag's shoes.
And?
There were two types. The predominant soil was a very rich humus, like the kind gardeners plant things in.
That would figure.
But there were also large traces with the same acidic components as the stolen dirt.
Good. I noticed the footprints Mailbag's shoes were making, and they looked like the ones we saw at the gravel pit.
It's a long shot, George.
Something else, folks. Guess what Merle Fish did the day after the heist?
Went to prison.
Nope. They didn't catch him until about a month later. The day after the robbery, he took out a building permit.
A building permit for what?
To build a carport.
That's right. In Tuesday's show, Mrs. Swaggle mentioned the house had a carport.
So?
So what?
That's right. So what? What if he built a carport? That's no crime, especially if he had a building permit.
That's true, but it is a pretty strange thing to do right after you've come into a million simoleons. You know, dollars.
Wait a minute. What if the accomplice theory is wrong?
About the robbery?
Yes. What if he didn't have an accomplice? He robbed the armored truck and took the money home. He figured they'd have a record of the loot, so he knew he couldn't spend it.
What if he intended to keep it until the statute of limitations expired? That's 3 years. That means if no one is convicted of the crime in that time, the case is closed.
And what if he buried the money under the carport and figured to spend it all later?
It's an interesting theory, but it's still just a theory.
And it's a long way from 3 dump truck loads of dirt.
But wait a minute. If we figure this out, somebody else
could have figured it out too.
Story you're about to see is a fib, but it's short. The names are made up, but the problems are real.
2:43 p.m., a night and morning low clouds mixed with haze from fires in Angeles Crest National Forest had merged with the smog and nearly obscured the Los Angeles Basin. We were working the day watch out of Mathnet. My partner is George Frankly, the boss is Thad Green. My name is Monday, I'm a mathematician. The original case we were working on involved 3 truckloads of stolen dirt, but we had come quite far afield from that. Now it looked as if we were working on an old case that involved $1 million robbery and money that was never recovered. We decided to look at some of yesterday's show to check out 2 hypotheses.
Wait a minute. What if the accomplice theory is wrong?
About the robbery?
Yes. What if he didn't have an accomplice? He robbed the armored truck and took the money home. He figured they'd have a record of the loot, so he knew he couldn't spend it.
What if he intended to keep it until the statute of limitations expired? That's 3 years. That means if no one is convicted of the crime in that time, the case is closed.
And what if he buried the money under the carport and figured to spend it all later?
It's an interesting theory, but it's still just a theory.
And it's a long way from 3 dump truck loads of dirt.
But wait a minute. If we figure this out, somebody else
could have figured it out too.
Thank you, and if you could hurry, I'd appreciate it.
Eureka! Eureka. That means I have found it.
That's not my line. Archimedes said it.
What have you got?
I looked up how much $1 million weighs, and it's a lot. $1,001,000 bills weighs about 2,200 pounds.
But there were no $1 bills in the Finks job. They were all fives.
That's right. And $1 million in $5 bills weighs about...
One-fifth as much.
One-fifth of 2,200 pounds is 440 pounds. That's too much for a man to carry.
What's your point?
Remember Mailbag said he was going on a short vacation?
Uh-huh.
And did you notice what Mailbag was taking on his short vacation?
Yes, come to think of it, he had about 6 bags.
And a steamer trunk. A steamer trunk that could hold the money.
Yes, but you can't arrest a man for carrying too many clothes on a short vacation.
Something else. We have his footprints, and did you see his fingernails?
What about them?
They were caked with dirt.
Yes, but he was working in his garden, so naturally...
But Kate, he was wearing gardening gloves, remember?
Yes, you're right. He took one off to shake hands.
But maybe he wasn't wearing the gloves when he was digging through the dirt he stole.
George, I think we better pay a call on our writer friend. Mathnet Monday. Oh, really? And it sails at 6 p.m.? Thank you very much. George, we've got to hurry. Mailbag is leaving the country on a cruise for Argentina that sails at 6 o'clock tonight. Let's roll.
We thought we were onto something. The evidence was not conclusive, but we were pretty sure we were right. Sometimes when you're solving a problem, whether it's mathematical or not, the thing to do is to play out your best hypotheses. That's exactly what we were doing.
Good afternoon, sir. Wonder if we could ask you a couple of more questions?
Look, you two, I cooperated with you yesterday and I told you all I know about the case. If you need to know anything more, reread my book.
Yes, sir, but if I may.
You may not. I'm going away on a vacation in a few minutes and I don't want to be late.
Maybe we can help you pack your car.
That won't be necessary. I'm having a carting service move my things.
That's an unnecessary expense, sir. George and I can help you lift your things.
Leave them alone.
I went over your book again, Mr. Mailbag, and a couple of things don't make sense.
Like what?
Like, where did Fish put the money right after he robbed the bank?
He and his accomplice hid the money in a locker in the bus station.
It would have to have been a very large locker, Mr. Mailbag.
It was a very large locker, Mr. Frankly.
They could have done that, I guess. But when did they move the money?
They didn't move the money. About a month later, Fish was tracked down. He was arrested for the crime and he went to prison. That's when his accomplice moved the money from the locker and left the country. Now, I don't wish to appear rude, but I must be leaving.
How could one man move $1 million? It weighed nearly 440 pounds.
He made 5 or 6 trips.
He could have done that, I guess.
And that's what he did do.
That's not what I think happened.
I don't care what you do or don't think. Please leave.
What I think happened is that Fish kept the money.
And he didn't have an accomplice?
Oh, he had an accomplice, all right, but he didn't trust him.
That's ridiculous.
He was afraid his accomplice was greedy and might want to spend the money right away.
If he did that, the cops could trace him and catch the two of them.
Well, the cops did catch Fish. So, where was the money?
It was never found.
It was never found because the accomplice had it.
It was never found because Fish buried it and poured a concrete carport over it so no one could find it, especially the accomplice.
Did you know that Merle Fish died last week, Mr. Mailbag?
No, I didn't.
But you did know he was very sick.
Yes, I knew that the last time I visited him.
Here's something else you don't know. On his deathbed, he made a statement. He told us who his accomplice was.
That's ridiculous. If he was going to do that, he wouldn't have told me where he hid the money.
We informed him of his rights and continued our interrogation. And did he tell you where it was, Mr. Mailbag?
Did he tell you he had buried it?
And did you go back to his house and find it had been torn down?
And did you hijack those trucks so you could sift through the dirt?
And did you find the money at the gravel pits?
And did you bring the money back here and pack it in your steamer trunk?
And did you book a passage on the SS Falklands intending to take a short vacation in Argentina?
And did you intend never to come back here?
Would you go over that a little slower, please?
And did he tell you where it was, Mr. Mailbag? And
did you go back to his house?
All right. I did it. I was Fisher's accomplice. And you're right. He didn't trust me. He hid the money and he never told me where it was. When he knew that he was going to that big prison yard in the sky, he realized that he couldn't use it. And the last time I visited him, well, he told me where he'd buried it. The rest you know.
One thing still puzzles me, Mr. Mailbag.
What's that?
Why did you write that book? Weren't you afraid you'd lead the police to you?
Just the opposite. I wrote it to throw the cops off my trail. I kept visiting Fish, trying to make him tell me where the money was. And then I wrote the book to make it look as though Fish had told me his accomplice took it.
Fish figured he'd be out of prison someday and could dig up the money and be on his way.
That's right. He told me we'd split it when he got out. I guess there's one thing he didn't figure, and one thing I didn't figure.
How's that?
Well, he didn't figure he'd be leaving feet first. And I didn't figure that he'd tell you the truth before he died.
He didn't.
He didn't?
We were playing a hunch.
A hunch? Do you know how that makes me feel?
Pretty silly, I'll bet. Your horoscope was sure right today, Kate.
Oh, what did it predict?
It said a new man enters your life and finds you arresting.
Norman Mailbag was arrested by the ever-vigilant LAPD for his participation in the Finks Armored Car Robbery and sentenced to an appropriate number of years away from society. When last heard from, he was writing another book. It is tentatively titled, I Feel Pretty Silly.